The clicking of the mechanisms with the device is a rhythmic thing, like a drum beat, like soldiers marching in perfect, helpless unison. Ditto. Okay. Entree. As your consciousness coalesces, you find yourself in an underground bunker which is shaking from an attack far above. You stand mid-salute in front of a cast-off encased in an articulated metal carapace. He's so skeletal you doubt he could move within it. You remember his name is Lovak, Paj Rekin's second-in-command in the endless battle. Three advisors sit behind him. Lovak shakes his synth-encased head and addresses you. Don't worry about the message, Barricale. What's Barricale? It has been rendered moot. We're just lucky Commander Rekin made it out of Mila Vest alive. She missed the destruction of the sanctuary by moments. Does this take place right after the... right after Mila Vest was destroyed? The massacre? It must. Yeah, they're hiding out here. A thunderous explosion rocks the bunker, sending everyone staggering. As you can see, we have troubles of our own, Lovak says, getting back to his feet. The Changing God's latest ploy has paralyzed the Reconciler of Truth. Of course, Heaven's rejoinder remains functioning, which means we cannot reverse their successes while they can reverse ours. Heaven's rejoinder. He leads you to a strategy table showing a three-dimensional projection of a battlefield across parallel realities. He swipes through several images. All of them show your army on the verge of defeat. He shakes his head. We are more in danger now of losing this war than since the first died. I'm afraid I must send you out again, Barricale. We must save the Reconciler. Okay. Questions? The massacre at Mila Vest. How did the massacre at Mila Vest massacre happen? How the shields come down. Where is the Reconciler of Truth and Heaven's Rejoinder? Yeah. Let me ask him where these are, because we kind of know what happened there. Lovak laughs. Again, eh? I suppose one of the hazards of dancing so often through realities and times is that it plays hell with memory. Not to worry. I'll explain it once more. Centuries ago, when the first still lived, she found the Reconciler, a machine of the ancients which allowed the user to look at multiple versions of a recent event and lock reality onto the one they liked best, making it the only reality. With it, she began choosing realities in which we had won more battles than we had lost, and quickly drove the Changing God to the brink of defeat. Really? That's pretty awesome. You know what? It's interesting. It's like she's reloading a save and trying again. And then once she has like the best possible choice that she feels she's gonna get, saves. It's like a game. Until that is, he acquired his own machine, Heaven's Rejoinder, which can undo the Reconciler's realities and make its own. So he found his own. He can, like, delete her saves. Pretty cool. Since then, our war has become one of feint and counterfeint, of competing and collapsing realities, where no battle is ever entirely won or completely lost, where both sides look always for a final advantage. He sighs and looks at the table, where one by one the multiple battlefields are beginning to wink out, narrowing down to one. And it seems as if the Chalcedon, the Changing God's general, may have found his advantage at last. With the Reconciler sabotaged, and Heaven's Rejoinder well defended, we may never turn the tide. How did the massacre at Mila Vest happen? How did the shields come down? I don't know. Maybe the Sorrow finally grew strong enough to smash through. Maybe there was a traitor. I have heard nothing. I am ready to serve. Excellent, says Lovak, and turns to his advisors, all cast-offs, you notice. Friends, what are your suggestions? How do we undo what has been done to the Reconciler without using the Reconciler? A scarred female cast-off in red armor speaks up. I recommend an all-out assault on the I recommend an all-out assault on the position of Heaven's Rejoinder. This will, of course, fail, but it will give cover for Barricale to slip through the paths of the white nests and reach the Rejoinder from behind. There she can reset it, then destroy it. She pounds the table. Then we will be the only side who can change history. A male mutant, exquisitely beautiful except for the second mouth in his throat, speaks in melodious harmony. I suggest Barricale use the reality storm that ravages No Man's Land to find the Reconciler's saboteur. If she can navigate the shifting shards, she can stop the saboteur before he reaches it. He shrugs. This will only return us to the status quo, of course, but it will be easier for Barricale to deal with one man than the deadly white nests. Any other suggestions? Asks Lovac. When there is no answer, he turns to you. I approve of either path. As it is you who will face these challenges, I leave it to you which you will choose. What do you say? Tell me more about these white nests. The white nests are the catacombs where the Chalcedon breeds his Stratharian war moths. A horrible place. I don't know what the tunnels were originally used for, but now they're a tangled mess of webs and larvae. It's filled with traps, since the enemy knows the tunnels are a vulnerable approach, but the real danger is the moths themselves, horrible creatures whose phosphorescent glow withers the flesh and maddens the mind. He shivers. Once they sense your presence, they will not rest until you are dead. It won't be an easy approach, by any means. Tell me about the reality storm. Lovac shakes his head. We and the Changing God have used the Reconciler of Truth and Heaven's Rejoinder so often and at such cross purposes that there are places in the No Man's Land between our front lines where no single reality holds sway. Fractured ripples of possibility drift across the field like squalls of rain, changing all in their path and offering entry into other times and versions of the present. And of course, once one enters a different version of reality, then all the shards one encounters in that reality are different too. He pales. It is the less deadly route, but it's still possible to be lost forever in such a maze. White nests with moths and more danger? This actually sounds more interesting to me. Fractured ripples of possibility, changing all on their path, offering entry into other times and versions of the present. Sounds like a fun ride. I will find the saboteur before he breaks the Reconciler, no matter what time or reality he does it in. Lovac nods, then looks at the others. Any objections to Barricale's choice? I approve, says the cast-off with two mouths. It can be done quickly, and the risk is low. And if Barricale is lost, says the cast-off in red armor, we can try the assault I suggested with someone else running through the white nests. Very well, says Lovac, standing. Barricale, these are the gloves of the saboteur. You'll use these, their scent and their tides, to navigate the shards and find your man. The gloves of the saboteur. Under heavy guard and with force shields and temporal randomizers in place, Lovac escorts you to the edge of No Man's Land. It is scarred with trenches and thick with roiling smoke, but more unnerving are the drifting shards of time and reality that cross it like summer storms. In one, great armies move. In another, towering constructs with glowing eyes burn the homes of fleeing villagers. And on and on. Lovac points ahead. There, somewhere, is your path. Use your instincts to hunt this villain down, but take care. Too many jumps and you will enter realities where the storm is fading, the shards closing. You could be trapped in a distant reality with no way back. Right. Don't do too many jumps, got it. You thank Lovac, then walk toward the storm of shards, holding the saboteur's gloves in one hand. Strange as it seems, the scheme seems to be working. Some of the shards do not have the right smell at all, and you were able to scout them entirely. Some are harder to decide upon, but eventually you are able to narrow it down to three. A moonlit lake, a canyon full of glancing sun and flitting shapes, and a storm of swirling chaos. Where would you be hiding? Get a drink. Should I go right for the chaos? Let's choose the moonlit lake. Look at me with 25 intelligence. That's freaking awesome. You are floating in a dark lake next to a large square raft. On it, kneeling in perfect rows, are 100 women, all bald, all with strange brass devices on their backs, and all praying. In unison, they press their foreheads to the planks, and their devices open. A vapor rises from them, then combines into a twisting white column which snakes to the far side of the lake. Looking in that direction, you see another raft, crowded with praying monks, also emitting a snaking vapor. In the middle of this strange conflict, the reality storm stirs the waters. You swim for it, but only the shard you left matches the scent of the gloves. You step back into the reality you know, and face your choices again. Take a look at where you are again. This is your reality, yours and Barricale's. You are in no man's land. It is scarred with trenches and thick with roiling smoke. Drifting shards of time and reality cross it like summer storms. I have a feeling it's in the swirling chaos, but if I can avoid the swirling chaos, I think it would be a good idea. Choose the sunny canyon. Oh, I got three more now. You stand at the edge of a sunlit canyon, watching an aerial battle between naked men and women strapped into wood and cloth glide wings. Half of the wings bear the colors of the changing god, the other half bear the firsts. The flyers slash at each other with long razored poles, trying to tear fabric and flesh, and every now and then a wing goes spiraling down into the canyon. You see the shard storm swirling on a mesa in the middle of the canyon, and race for the bridge that leads to it. Three shards feel promising: a dense forest at night, rolling farmland in the setting sun, and a muddy battlefield in the rain. Is this by pure chance I'm going to find this guy? Because if I go to too many of these portals, it's not going to be good for me. Muddy battlefield? Good God. On a muddy battlefield battered with rain and littered with bodies and broken mantis war constructs, the Chalcedon stares, stands with the rest of his command as Paj Rekkan and her generals kneel before him and she offers him her sword. All around this scene, the Chalcedon soldiers are leading away Paj's surviving troops, both cast-off and human. There aren't many left. Most are dead on the field and being picked over by Murden corpse thieves. Beyond them, you can just see the reality storm's shifting ripples. You hurry through the rain toward them, and as you get close, three of them seem better than the others. A glimmering swamp, a plain of giant bonfires, and a frantic battle. Giant bonfires. In the glow of raging bonfires, huge teams of slaves haul on ropes, dragging two 50-meter high-wheeled statues toward each other, as overseers crack whips across their backs. The statues are crude representations of the changing god and the first, made of painted wood, and upon each of their heads stands a hero, cloak flapping, sword at the ready, screaming amplified insults at the other in a language you do not understand. You don't wait to see the statues and their heroes collide. Instead, you race for the reality storm, just visible in the darkness beyond the fires, but only the shard you left matches the scent of the gloves. You dive back into the muddy battlefield to try again. Take a look at where you are again. Choose the glimmering swamp. It is night. You are hip deep in a stinking swamp, watching hideously mutated primitives flee through a maze of reeds and drooping trees as soldiers in the colors of the first stalk them, firing beam weapons. You back into the shadows as two of the soldiers pass your position, and you see that they are not human. Though they walk upright on their hind legs and have paws with opposable thumbs, they are sesky hounds, somehow evolved into humanoid shape. As the hunt vanishes again into the night, you see the shimmer of reality storm through the trees, and approaching it, you find that three of the shards seem more likely than the rest. A gloomy battlefield, an arena full of roaring crowds, and a maze of grimy gray streets. Is this the same battlefield we're in? Let me try the grimy streets. You are on a grimy street in a city of gray brick. Plastered on every wall are the posters of the changing god, looking noble, with underneath the motto, Unchanging. Changing god, unchanging, what? A troop of armored police march past. The people cringe back from them. You step into an alley and find yourself among a ragtag group in the colors of the first, who watch the police, then charge out behind them with makeshift weapons. You retreat from the ensuing melee and seek the reality storm. You find it in a bombed-out block, behind a razor wire fence. Slashing through, you approach, but only one shard matches the scent of the gloves, the one you just left. You step back into the glimmering swamp to try again. Choose the roaring arena. You find yourself in the stands of a large arena, surrounded by a cheering, boozy crowd. On the grass-covered floor of the arena, two teams of men and women in heavy-parted armor play some sort of game that involves whacking a hovering orb with wooden clubs and knocking each other down. The fans cheer and raise their cups at each impact. Go, gods, cries one side. Come on, cast-offs, calls the other. Sneaking from the arena, you see the reality storm half hidden in a high-walled enclosure nearby. You hurry to it and climb it, then drop inside, but find that there are far fewer shards than in earlier realities, and Lovak's warning comes back to you. You are making too many jumps. If you take too many more, you could wind up trapped in a distant reality. Worse, only the shard you left matches the scent of the gloves. You step back into the glimmering swamp to try again. Choose the gloomy battlefield. It's the only way to go. A train of transport sleds glides to a stop on a desolate battlefield, and Paj Rekin steps out with her command and looks around. For as far as the eye can see, the field is covered in corpses, both outcast and human, burned to sticks inside their uniforms. There are no living troops at all. The only movement is the rolling smoke that rises from the broken hulks of shattered war machines. Paj chokes to see it all. Is this what victory looks like? She asks, then hangs her head. What have we done? What have we done? Off to the west, half hidden in a gray haze, the reality storm churns. You edge from blue and from view and scurry toward it. And as you near it, you see, looming within a shard, the massive form of the Reconciler of Truth. Without hesitation, you leap through. Cool. Landing near the Reconciler, you see none of the guards who usually protect it, nor the walls or doors that shield it. In fact, it isn't in its chamber at all. Instead, it seems to be in some sort of bubble outside time and space. You circle it and find, crouching by the far side of it, a wiry man in dark armor, focused on cutting through its metal skin. You recognize him as Zeronth, one of the Chalcedon's wiliest operatives, whom Barrichellis tangled with more than once. Kind of looks friendly. As you creep up on him, he whips around, alarmed. He throws his hands in front of him, pleading. Bruna, he gasps. Wait, hear me out. I have information you need to know. Tell me. You know that the Sorrow has destroyed Mila Vest, yes? Well, know that it was your commander, Paj Rekin, who dropped the compound shields and allowed it to enter. That is why she was there, and how she escaped in time, he snarls, overcome. Really? Paj Rekin? Mila Vest has always been a place of peace. Paj broke that truce. So many of our brothers and sisters dead, more than ever, died in this foolish war. He looks you in the eye. I know you to be an honorable opponent, Bruna, but your leader is savage and insane. If you care for the future of the castoffs, go back to her and confront her. Stop her from killing any more of us. Should I attack him? Can I trust him? Go, and I will consider it. Otherwise... You think I'm going to fight Barakael, the Living Blade? I am no fool. He bows and steps away from the Reconciler, then turns and dives through a reality shard and is gone. As he leaves, the bubble around the machine fades, and it returns to its proper place in time. You turn to the shards to do the same. Hope you made the right choice there. You retrace your steps through the reality storm and return to Lovak's bunker. He greets you with open arms and a smile. Success, my friend. Whatever you did, the Reconciler is operational once again, and we have recovered our recent losses. I have told Paj Rekin of your heroism, and she wants to thank you personally. Go to her now. She's in the bloom, meeting with the Memovira. I believe she has more work for you there. Saran told me Commander Rekin was the one who turned off Milavash's shields, allowing the sorrow to kill our siblings. Lovak scowls. Lies, most likely meant to turn you against our commander. I would not speak this foolishness to her when you see her. It will lower her opinion of you. Now go. Curious. What if I say, I do not wish to go. I want to continue to serve you. What you or I want matters not. If the commander orders it, it will be. Now off you go. With a bow, you leave the bunker and find the Z-Drake roost. Then you mount the drake the grooms have saddled for you and fly towards Sagus Cliffs. When you reach it, you bank toward its base and land near their living mountain of flesh that is the bloom. The guards at the nearest orifice tell you Paj Rekin is with the Memovira, and after entering and traveling through the bloom's canals, you reach her fortress. Her guards admit you without a word, and you are ushered into an antechamber and told to wait. From behind a door, you hear the voice of Paj Rekin, raised in frustration. If the sorrow is strong enough to enter Milavest, Paj is saying, then it's our primary enemy. We must either finish the Changing God quickly, or unite with him to destroy it. The voice you recognize as the Memovira's answers, which is of course the first cast-off, you found out. You have it reversed, sister. We will use the sorrow to destroy the Changing God. All we must do is turn it his way. Paj groans. And if I'm to take this message to the survivors, that they should let the monster which killed us walk free, hoping it might strike our enemy first? Why don't you tell them, sister? Why not reveal yourself at last? The door slides open, and the Memovira enters. It isn't time, She cuts off as she sees you. Who is this? Paj enters the room behind her, then nods. Ah, Barakael. The loyal blade you asked me to send for. And it seems she has already learned your secret. The Memovira gives you a hard look. Then she had better be loyal indeed. Introduce us. Barakael, says Paj. May I present the first, our brave leader. So brave she's hidden behind my skirts for over 100 years. I thought my name was Bruna. Enough, Paj, snaps the first, then looks at you over. I ask Commander Rekin to bring me the best. For in the coming days I will have need of an agent who will act without flinching, no matter what the order. Is that you, Barakael Bruna? Okay. Bruna is the last name. Got it. Are you ready to do anything to stop the Changing God? What are the other answers? Yeah, thank you. Paj, Savon told me the sorrow did not claim the shields were lower in purpose by you. That may lower her opinion of me, the other guy said. I'll do anything you ask. It'll be an honor, blah, blah, blah. I am honored, but my loyalty, I will do as Paj orders. I'm going to say it, rather than just attack. Paj, Zoran told me the sorrow did not break through Milavash's shields. He claims the shield was lowered on purpose by you.
I'll remember that.
You best to remember it. Ha, huh, says Paj. He lies. Marilel sent me to await the arrival of the Changing God's last child. The sorrow did not attack the compound until I had returned and reported. Paj looks at the first, suspicion dawning. I told you the last child was in the compound, and then the sorrow attacked it. Sister, please tell me these two events are not related. Please? The child had to be killed, says the first. I knew of no better way to do it. She tried to kill us. Paj stares at her. You let them die? Our siblings? Adiris? Not all, says the first. To save the vast majority of our siblings, I was forced to risk the deaths of the few at the compound. Well, biatch, you didn't even kill me. Me, the last cast off, I'm still alive anyway. And now you know that, because we've got audience with you. Wasted, sputters Paj. The child escaped. It was worth the risk, says the first. Paj buries her face in her hands. Perhaps, but... She looks up again. But you could have told me. You could have let me warn Dearest. Others loyal to us. You... I could not. Anyone you warned might have warned the child. It was impossible. Then you could have ordered me to bring Adiris here, shouts Paz. I didn't have to know why. Any pretense would have done. Instead, you followed Adiris. Adiris was a mother to us all, interrupts the first. Too kind-hearted, by far, for the coming conflict. Paz stares again. You let her die. Deliberately. The first turns from Paj. A leader's decisions are never easy. You should know that by now. She looks at you. So, Barakale, now you know all my secrets. Will you still serve? Will you see our war for survival to its conclusion? Or will you turn from the inevitable out of foolish sentiment? Yes, I'll do anything you ask. It'll be an honor. I'm honored. Wow, this is a big decision. And we'll do as Paj orders. Let Paj make the decision. Rather than just, yes, I am a real willing zombie, or attack, which I probably won't win. I am honored to be chosen, but my loyalty is to the commander I have known all these years. I will do as Paj orders. The first looks from you to Paj, and back, thinking. Then I shall have to trust that Paj remains loyal to me, won't I? She turns to Paj. General, what are your orders for your blade? Paj faces you, squaring her shoulders. Barakale, protect the first and follow her orders in all things. As of now, she is your commander, not I. Okay, now we'll attack her. As the first welcomes you, a force like a fist starts to wrench you back to your own body. The last thing you hear is your new commander saying, The last child is coming, Barakale. We must be prepared. Okay, so because of that, now I have to fight Barakale as well. Addendum added. The first cast-off was the one behind the destruction of Milavast. She dropped the shields in an attempt to kill me. Wow, man.
We shall see.
Anything new to say in light of all this?
Yes, lass.
Nope.
What's on your mind?
I couldn't be happier with you if you were another me. Okay. We've been standing still for too long. Well... need to have a talk with Guard Koto about his people. We're going back inside. And going to deal with, well, the first cast off. And it looks like, it's Barakale Bruna and possibly Paj Rekin as well. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next episode. And endure. In enduring, grow strong.